say, I'm honored to be able to speak today about David Smale. I've known David since 1979 when he was an anesthesiologist, and I was an orderly in the operating room. This was back in the days of single-digit medical record numbers. We both worked very closely with Mary Fletcher and Fanny Allen. But enough history. When I first met Dave, like everybody else, I was impressed by his intelligence and by his phenomenal memory, which apparently has allowed him to store every joke ever heard. And they're immediately available. It's like the National Library of Jokes up in the state. So he also had a remarkable sense of fairness, and he treated everyone equally, whether you worked in the cafeteria, whether you were chief of surgery, or whether you were an OR orderly. He never put himself above others. I remember one weekend going up to get a patient to bring down to surgery. And when I returned, there was David Smale swinging a mop to get the room ready. He wasn't swinging at random, he was actually way back before the days of being one, David was the quintessential team player. I worked in quintessential. David's enthusiasm for knowledge made anatomy and physiology, physics and psychology interesting, accessible, and really cool. He inspired my interest in anesthesia, and I know that he's motivated scores of medical students and nurses to seek careers in anesthesia. Now, a lot of things have changed since those days, but I believe that David still operates by these same precepts. First, treat people well. If you've ever watched him listening attentively to a patient's concerns, you've seen this in action. And I believe that the good that David's done by listening to people over the years is incalculable. Second, tell the truth. Be honest. For him, honesty isn't the best policy, it's the only policy. The flip side of that is, don't ever ask David, do these pants make my hips look big? Because he'll tell you, no, your hips make your hips look big. Okay. He's right over there. See, he's right over there. I know that he has a lot to say, so without further ado, I'm pleased to present my teacher, my role model, and my good friend, David Smale.
Well, that's good for 2 minutes. Thank you all for coming. Good morning. Please leave your cell phones on. It might be entertaining to hear your conversations. And I don't mind a little competition. I think I have too many slides. A long time ago, I decided that if you want to really engage your audience, you shouldn't have too many slides. One day, Mr. Bajan came back from an anesthesia meeting and he said, I just saw the most exciting thing. Each speaker had two slides. I said, you mean each speaker had only two slides? He said, no, two at once. So when I was asked to talk at our STOE meeting on management of chronic pain, I thought, I'll put my money where my mouth is and have just one slide. I showed one slide for an hour. This slide. And I think it was a good talk. I think I did engage the audience. The reviews were mixed. I was not invited back. I also think I have too many words. I thought about asking someone who can speak much faster than I to read a presentation for me, maybe a pediatric anesthesiologist, somebody like that. So no, I really have to do this myself. And actually, I probably will stop talking altogether at some point, because I always do. Every presentation I've given in daily conversation, and people think, has he lost his place? Is he having a little petit mal seizure? No, I'm thinking. I call it a long latency, and here's my explanation. Thinking. So what I want to do today is present a kind of an autobiographical scaffolding and hang some stories on it, because I like stories. And I just hope that each of you here hears at least one new one. So I was born in California, where my father was an Army officer, and lived there for just a few months, didn't leave much of a mark. Moved to El Paso for another few months. My mother said, you used to play out in the sun all day long, every day. You used to get just as brown as a little nut. Thanks, Mom. I don't think El Paso left a mark either, or a lesion, I hope. And then when Dad shipped off to France, we moved back to Massachusetts, where family was, and that's where I grew up. The family lore is that every night before I went to bed, I'd kiss my father's picture goodnight, and when he came home, I was two, I recognized him. And I had a very idyllic childhood. It was father knows best. I remember Mama, leave it to Beaver. It was swell. In middle school, I was athletic. Yes, Kayla, I was. I was quicker. Something changed in high school. In high school, I did not make the freshman baseball team. I was successful. Class play, yearbook, I was valedictorian. My father died a month after I graduated, sadly. And then I went off to college at Bowdoin, where I did very well the first year, very good grades. I should mention, in high school, I did have one problem. Whenever I was with a girl I really, really liked, any girl that I really liked, I'd get sick to my stomach. And sometimes vomit. So the doctor gave me some pills. They were beautiful little things. They didn't help. I was able to date girls I didn't care for. So at Bowdoin, I made two discoveries. The first discovery was that my nausea and vomiting problem was gone. And the second discovery was beer. So at the end of my sophomore year, I was elected president of my fraternity. And my grades slipped. No, my grades plummeted. And I was really restless. I majored in chemistry because I always wanted to be a sorcerer. But that major required industry I just didn't have at the time. I was really restless. I just thought I'd fly fighter jets over Vietnam. So I went to the recruiters, and I did very well on the Air Force flight aptitude test, very well on the Navy flight aptitude test, and I failed every color vision test they had. What a stroke of good luck. So I went back to class. And I did graduate on time, without honors. My good friend, a year ahead of me, always wanted to be a doctor because his grandfather was a doctor. He applied to a bunch of medical schools, got rejected by all of them, and became an insurance salesman. And I caught his enthusiasm, and miraculously, I was accepted at Tufts Medical School. And as far as I know, I'm still on the waiting list at Dartmouth. So, now, who here has Googled his own name? Okay, you not raising your hands, you're liars. Okay, 99%. So I Googled my name. And I found me, I found my son, I found a psychologist who's written a lot of books, I found a professional golfer who never seems to make the big time, and I found a poem called Old David Smale by Robert W. Service. And Mr. Service is said to be they called him the Kipling of Canada. I think that's more accurate than any horoscope out there. And it's better than his other poems are kind of doggerel. A bunch of the boys were whooping it up at the Malamute Saloon, but I like this. So I did okay at Tufts. My problem there was that I liked everything. I especially liked my pulmonary rotation. I liked sputum. I really liked looking at eosinophils through the microscope. I was going to be a sputologist. And it was during that, I'm close, right? During that time, my mother asked me, you know, the way mothers do, when do you think you'll get married? And I, you know, here I am, a single medical student living in Boston. I have a little British sports car, married. I said, I don't know. Someday I'll feel like it. I'll look around, see who's there. And she said, nope, you're going to get clobbered. And she was right. I remember the exact moment. I was on the subway, hanging from the strap, and I realized I have to marry Barbara. No other future is possible. I'd met her by the Coke machine in the lounge that we shared with the School of Occupational Therapy. She had transferred there from the Boston Museum School of Art. We were married between my second and third year, and I needed money, so I got a job at the Deaconess as a phlebotomist. I got a second job as a blood gas technician at the Brigham, and I joined the Air Force so that they would pay for my fourth year and I would owe them 3 years. So I remember my first night as a blood gas technician. I'd been trained. I'm sleeping there in the room, and there's a knock on the door. I open the door. There's my first specimen. It's a glass syringe in a bag of ice. I bring it in, calibrate my instrument, pick up the syringe, take the needle off, hold the syringe vertically. The plunger fell out. Now, a more experienced person would have called the ICU and said, your sample clotted, send another. I put the syringe back together, sucked up the blood, put it into the machine, athlete's foot and all. And the results, I remember, were remarkably close to room air. I did graduate. I did my internship at the University of Oregon, which is a beautiful place, unlike many hospitals, teaching hospitals. It's on a hill surrounded by rose gardens. Barbara says my internship was very traumatic for me. She said I didn't speak for a year. It was a transitional year, what we called then a rotating zero. Not a great name, is it? But I remember on my anesthesia rotation when I realized they didn't know if I was there or not, stopped going. David Jr. was born in Portland. He was conceived on a fishing boat in the Florida Keys. I think that explains his lifelong passion for fishing. After internship, I had 3 months before reporting for active duty and I needed money again. So I got a job as a psychiatrist at Damish State Hospital. Now, this is not One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, but it's not pleasant. It's a state hospital for people, essentially everybody has been involuntarily committed. It was after I left that I heard about the stories of various kinds of patient abuse. What I did see was no talk therapy, a lot of heavy-duty tranquilizers, ECT, and five-point restraints. We took turns admitting patients. One of my first days as admitting officer, deputy brought this guy in, and we're in my office, and I'm trying to have a conversation with him, but he's talking a mile a minute, and he's pacing back and forth. He's emptied the ashtrays. He's tidied up my desk. He's starting to wash the windows. And I said, I think you should be on lithium. And he said, that's what they usually do. Later on, it was my turn. The sheriff brought in this woman who had been committed by the court. I knew she'd been committed. Amazingly, I had no paperwork to explain why she had been committed. Anyway, I want you to picture a woman twice my age. I was 26. She's very well-dressed, well-spoken, very composed. She's sitting across the desk from me, and I'm doing my intake interview. And she tells me that she's the heiress to a European fortune, and her family has conspired to have her committed so they can get the money. I know, sounds crazy, but she spoke so well and so coherently, I began to think maybe a mistake's been made. And then I said, and these were my exact words, tell me about your previous life. And she said, in my previous life, I was a lobster. I said, that sounds crazy to me. And she said, that's what the judge said. So I found her a bed. So we drove up the Alaska Highway. It was a thrill to fill my windshield washer reservoir with water from the Yukon River. I was stationed at Elmendorf Air Force Base in Anchorage, where I was going to spend 3 years as a general medical officer. I was the least trained person in a staff of 40 people, but they made me the chief of the ER and the director of the general therapy clinic, which was not about generals, it was about primary care. And that's where I learned that I could actually do this medicine thing. Early on, so I was taking care of airmen, dependents, and retirees. The pilots, the officers, they were seen by people with good color vision over in the flight surgeons corridor. So early on, this old geezer came in. Is there such a thing as a young geezer? Anyway, this guy came in, he had a note from his primary care doctor. It said, dizziness, resistant to antivert, which is meclizine for vertigo, please treat. Okay, so I did two things his primary care doctor evidently didn't do. First, I listened to the old guy. I said, tell me about your dizziness. He said, I don't get dizzy, doc. I just pass out and fall down. And then I examined him, and his heart rate was 32. And he got a pacemaker that afternoon. I thought, wow, I think I can feed my family doing this. And then Mrs. Johnson came in, and the medic had written at the top of her chart, tired all the time, I thought. Another depressed housewife, saw a lot of them. I said, tell me about your problem. And she said, I'm so cold. My voice has changed. My periods have stopped. And look at my hair. Wow. And I said, you stop at the lab, get this blood drawn, pharmacy, get these pills, come back in a month. And she came back and said, I feel great. Of course, she was very hypothyroid. That was good. The bad part was she worked on the base. She lived on the base. She had a lot of friends on the base. And for months, women came in saying, you help Mrs. Johnson so much, and I'm tired all the time, too. Then the doctor who was scheduled to go to Shemya broke his back in a car crash. Some people will do anything to get out of going to Shenya. I was named to be the temporary guy for a month while they found a permanent replacement. Now, Shenya is a rock. Oh, that's young me. There's Shenya. You can see Anchorage. Shenya is not quite at the end of the Aleutian chain. I remember flying in. It was a very dark, very, very foggy night. A little plane just piloted up front, me in the back, and I could hear him talking to the ground. As we approached, he said, "I can't see your lights. Can you hear my engines?" But we landed. We landed. I discovered there are 1,000 men on this base, no women, one doctor, and a lot of listening devices. This is part of the dew line. You see the Soviet Union's not far away. And there were 3 crackerjack medics, people who had, these men had seen it all and done most of it. And they were the reason I could sleep at night. They were like our CRNAs and AAs in this department. They were superb. There was one night when I didn't sleep so well. I was asleep, there was a knock on the door, the medic woke me up and said, "Doc, we gotta go down to the airstrip. There's a plane coming in, Kuruv 2, the cockpit is filling up with avgas fumes." So we get in the ambulance, the 4 of us, we get down and park by the airstrip, the ground crew foams the runway, and you can imagine the scenarios going through my head and my heart rate. This was a very maturing experience for me, and I think all of you who take night call know this feeling. You know, whatever my failings might be, I'm it. I also remember the bravado of being young, you know, bring it on. Well, I outgrew that. Anyway, the plane landed, the crew got out, said, "Boy, we're glad to be down," and that was that. But still, it was quite an experience for me. Back at Elmendorf, I witnessed an event that moved me very much, even though it really had nothing to do with me. A blue baby was born, a baby with severe congenital cyanotic heart disease. And he needed emergency surgery. So the hospital commander called the base commander. The base commander called the Strategic Air Command, and they found a C-5A Galaxy, which at the time was the largest aircraft in the world, and still is, I think, the airlifter with the greatest capacity. It was on the way from Japan to home base in Dover, Delaware, and they diverted it to land at Anchorage. And I want you to imagine what I saw. Doctor and a nurse in uniform trundling this little bassinet across the tarmac, up the ramp, and into this cavern. And the plane took the infant to Seattle for the surgery. I don't know what moves me so much about this. The size of the bassinet compared to this behemoth, military might and power, and the machine, a fabulous, expensive machine, priorities suddenly turned. I think it's the idea of a giant's hand reaching down from the sky and helping a little one. So at Elmendorf, there were a lot of unhappy doctors. A lot of people had been drafted out of their residency plan, for example. I noticed one guy was happier than everybody else. That was the anesthesiologist. Maybe just being an anesthesiologist changed his practice the least, because Pentothal is Pentothal, after all. So I began to follow him around, and I made a career decision. Garen was born in Alaska. He was conceived in a remote cabin like this one. And I think that explains his passion for the backcountry. I came to Mary Fletcher because I found a father figure in John Mazuzu. I think many of us came here to join the residency and the faculty because of John Mazuzu. I interviewed with him, went back to Alaska, and then I wrote him a letter saying I'm a bit concerned because most of the cases seem to be halothane or spinal anesthesia. And he wrote back saying, "I have a farm system available if you have a burning desire to use ether." And I knew this was the right place. So to return to Massachusetts, Barbara and the boys flew. My brother Ken and I decided we would bicycle from Seattle back to New England. So we had some mishaps. I think it was the best shape I've ever been in. But then he had to leave early to fly back to school, and here I was all by myself, and the loneliness was crushing. It was a grief reaction. So in Minneapolis, I bailed out. I aborted, flew home. I still haven't biked across the country. Again, I had several months to fill. I needed money before starting my residency, and I found a job at the Fernal State School. And this is outside Boston. This is a state hospital for profoundly mentally disabled people. Forgive me, but when it opened in 1848, it was called the Massachusetts School for Idiotic Children. This place, too, had a shady past. Patient abuses of various kinds that used to practice eugenics. So these people, mostly nonverbal, I was supposed to care for their somatic needs. This is where I met a bird-headed dwarf. This is where I met some people with Lesch-Nyhan syndrome. They'll eat anything. They favor eating themselves. There was a 42-year-old man who succeeded in learning his primary colors. We had a party. I met a teenage girl who had untreated hydrocephalus. This means the spinal fluid made in her brain can't get up. So her head swelled enormously, and so successfully that the pressure didn't go up, so her intelligence was normal, but her head was gigantic. The story I heard was that she was born to a prominent Boston family. They were embarrassed by her condition. Instead of having her treated, they had her institutionalized. Her neck was not strong enough to support her head. Anesthesia residency was different then. It was only 2 years. Usually attendings were not assigned to rooms. They just roamed around the OR, assisting and teaching as they could. Residents ran the OR at night, second year residents. They called the attending in from home if it was necessary. And sometime during my second year, we had a visitor from out of town, and he needed a place to sleep. And Dr. Mazuzin said, "Smale, you're the chief resident. Find this man a bed." And that's how I was appointed chief resident. Then the boss offered me a job, and I accepted on the condition that I go someplace else for a year because I was concerned about inbreeding if I just stayed there. So he agreed, and I went to the Virginia Mason Clinic, and there I found the philosophy very similar, the emphasis on regional anesthesia even greater, and the department very academic. Of the 8 people on the staff, 6 of them were board examiners. And I did blocks I'd never done before. For example, the standard anesthetic for a laparotomy, say an open gallbladder. Put the patient prone, attending stands on one side, resident stands on the other. Each of us do 7 intercostal nerve blocks, 14 chances for a pneumothorax. Each of us does a celiac plexus block. Most people got 400 milligrams of bupivacaine. Turn them supine, pentothal, succinylcholine tube, nitrous oxide, that's it. These people were essentially pain-free for 24 hours. Maybe my biggest lesson, though, was that the boys and girls back home in the anesthesia department were doing a really good job. I think my most memorable patient was a very attractive 24-year-old woman who lived an alternative kind of hippie lifestyle on a houseboat down in Elliott Bay. And she had a spinal headache, thanks to the neurologist. So I had done an epidural blood patch, and she was on a stretcher, she was lying on her back, covered with a sheet, and I was moving very quickly toward the recovery area. And I didn't know that under that sheet, she was completely naked, because all I'd seen was this dinner plate-sized area of her lower back. So I'm zipping along, and the sheet at the leading edge, it's dangling lower and lower, and gets tangled in the wheels. And there she was in all her glory and nothing else. And I turn crimson, I can feel my face getting warm now. She was completely unconcerned. And in 35 years, I have not been able to reproduce that stuff. So I turned down a job offer there and I came home. Dr. Mazuzin appointed me to be director of esoteric blocks. and this eventually evolved into a pain management practice. It started with an occasional block. One of the surgeons asked me to see his father-in-law, who had metastatic cancer to his ribs. It was very painful. So I did some phenol intercostal nerve blocks. And he was pain-free. People sent me terminal cancer pain patients. I saw probably a dozen people. I put permanent epidurals in, a tunnel epidural catheter to the front where the person could see the exit site. And then they'd go home with a morphine pump and a shoulder bag that the VNA took care of. As I say, probably a dozen people like that. I think the longest one, about 6 months. It was kind of clumsy, but it was a lot cheaper than today's intrathecal pumps. I did celiac plexus blocks with absolute alcohol for pancreatic cancer pain. I had done a lot of celiac plexus blocks at the Mason Clinic, but I discovered a technique that I preferred, which was to use a single 6-inch needle on the left side and go through the aorta and out the other side. And you can't miss. You know you're there. I never paralyzed anybody or made anybody incontinent, but I think that's probably miraculous. I read about and then did neurolytic intrathecal injections. You have to remember that in spinal fluid, alcohol floats. Position the patient like this. Avoid the anterior roots that are the motor roots and the spinal cord. Phenol sinks. Sometimes that's the appropriate route. Use phenol if you want to do a neurolytic saddle block. So treating cancer pain was gratifying because almost all the time you can do something. Chronic non-cancer pain was different. It was frustrating and humbling. I got patients with what might have been reflex sympathetic dystrophy or CRIPS, chronic regional pain syndrome. I thought I knew what it was at the time. So I had to learn how to do sympathetic blocks like this stellate ganglion block. The first one I had ever seen was done by me. For the lower extremity, I did paravertebral lumbar sympathetic blocks. That was an easy step because it's very similar to the celiac plexus block. I experimented with thermal lesioning with an old dusty machine I found in the neurosurgery department. I never really was very successful. I didn't really know what I was doing. But that's the confidence I gained at the Mason Clinic, and that's also the confidence of a very young man. But I became disillusioned. Now I know, I don't know what RSV is. I don't know what CRIPS is. Neither do you, Carlos. If my stellate ganglion block made the wrist pain go away, did maybe I have just a little tiny bit of somatic sensory block that I couldn't detect, and that's why the pain went away? Or if my stellate ganglion block did not make the pain go away, does that mean it's not sympathetically mediated? How do I know I have a complete sympathetic block? Hand is warm and dry, but I wasn't measuring skin conductance or doing fancy things like this. Okay, consider this. I saw a 16-year-old girl with an eating disorder. She was skeletal. She couldn't eat because her stomach hurt all the time. So I did 14 intercostal nerve blocks, made her abdominal wall surgically anesthetic. This would not affect the organs inside, however. And she said, my pain's gone. And the GI doctor said, now what? And I answered like this. So parallel to doing these blocks, we introduced post-op epidurals to the hospital. This was being done in a few other places. This was more than a one-man job. Bruce Vianney and Brian Calhoun and I did two tutorials for each surgical ward on each shift, making sure we missed no surgical nurse. We wanted to tell them what epidurals were, how they worked, what to watch for. We also talked about intrathecal morphine. We had to convince a lot of skittish nurse managers that we knew what we were doing. At the time, we were using 10 mics of fentanyl and an epidural, not the usual four. Dr. Broman just said one day, that's strong enough to stand a spoon up in. So the Payne Service was officially born in 1988, making it one of the oldest in the country. We even got a resident of our own. In the morning, we would make quick morning rounds, see the first clinic patient at 9 a.m., and then at 3, we'd go down and do anesthesia for the MRIs. I contributed to the current explosion of opiate overuse. I became a disciple of Russell K. Portnoy, a New York anesthesiologist and pain management expert, who trumpeted the liberal use of narcotics. Used correctly, the dose will stay the same for years. There's no addiction potential used correctly. There'll be no cognitive or reflex impairment. You can drive your car. Look at all these people coming back from Vietnam addicted to heroin. They get back in the right environment, they're cured. I wrote a lot of prescriptions. Dr. Portnoy has still recanted and apologized, most recently about 6 months ago in an interview in the Wall Street Journal. I've recanted and apologized too. I realized I wasn't going to cure everybody by finding the right place to put the needle and the right stuff to squirt through it. So many of my chronic pain patients needed psychosocial rehabilitation. I know that's important, but it makes my eyes glaze over. I turned to the psychiatrist for help. They told me my patients were too crazy for them to see. So after a particularly long stretch in the pain clinic, I said to Bruce Fiani, I got to come back to the OR where the Pentothal always works. And Bruce said, we don't use Pentothal anymore. So in 1998, I resigned the pain clinic. Never been inside the building on Tilly Drive. I participated in 9 or 10 medical missionary trips to developing countries with Interplast, which is a group started by Don Lobb's father in Stanford. So these are teams of plastic surgeons, anesthesiologists, pediatricians, nursing staff who go to a clinic in a developing country for 2 weeks every year, and they work with local doctors. And the idea is, their motto is teach a man to fish, feed him for a year. By their own criterion, Interplast has failed. Their earliest clinic opened in Ecuador, still running decades later. It's very gratifying to take part in fixing something like this. But you have to wear blinders. You have to remember that if this repair falls apart after we leave, there's no one who can fix it till the team comes back the next year. She looks great, food doesn't come out her nose anymore, but there's no speech therapy in Peru. You haven't brought clean water, vaccinations, stable currency, and so on. But these experiences benefited me enormously. This is horribly trite, but I learned about what we human beings have in common. This girl's family lives in a hovel with a dirt floor. Her family tries very hard to keep her fed and healthy and clean as best they can, and they work very, very hard. And they would make wonderful legal immigrants. I think maybe my favorite patient, they didn't give him anesthesia. This was in Kathmandu. He was going to have arm surgery, and I said, would you like me to freeze your arm or put you to sleep? And he said, that won't be necessary. He lay down on the OR table, appeared to go to sleep, and he had his operation. And I just wrote on his anesthesia record, patient in self-induced trance. I think, do we all have that power? Can we tap that? I'd like to think we can. Barbara touched many lives. She was the president of the Vermont Women's Caucus for Art and of the Northern Vermont Artists Association. She had one-person shows in Massachusetts, Boston, New York, Vermont, New Hampshire, Pennsylvania. She taught watercolor and life drawing at the Community College of Vermont. And she was a co-founder of the Church Street Gallery. or the Firehouse Gallery on Church Street. And then she was diagnosed with central nervous system lymphoma, not common. She had very aggressive surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, finally a stem cell transplant. And after a year, she was in complete remission. She was getting stronger. She was starting to paint again. I came home one day and found that she had died hours before. Pathologists found no cause. I think she probably had a seizure because of the scar in her brain. So after 33 years, 5 months, and 3 days of marriage, I found myself more alone than I had ever been in my life. Barbara never got to meet her grandchildren. But I get to look for her face in theirs. And I got clobbered again. This time it was a different tree. I think it was not a redwood, it was a sequoia.
Hey, Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it better. Remember to let her into your home. Then you can start to make it better.
This was a package deal. You get Jude, you get Kayla. Having families in separate sections, sort of, is not always easy, but we do work at it. Jude's my partner. Now she's my fiance. We complement each other. That's with an E and with an I. We've begun to finish each other's sentences. We think soon we won't need to speak at all. She's a different kind of partner. I'm looking for a T-shirt for myself that says, "Just tell me what to do." She told me to put this next clip in. She says it illustrates something essential about me. I'll let you decide. Okay, first some drug errors. A woman having cesarean section under spinal anesthesia, her blood pressure a bit low. I wanted to give her 5 milligrams of ephedrine. Instead, I gave her 100 micrograms of adrenaline. Her heart was going like this, and there was no harm done, but she and I shared a feeling of impending doom. As a resident doing an abdominal hysterectomy, surgeon said, "Give 5,000 units of heparin." I said, "Really? I'd never heard of sub-Q heparin." He said, "5,000 units of heparin." So I said, "Okay." So I gave it intravenously, and the bleeding was stupendous. Then there's the wrong side category. The new resident and I were going to do a brachial plexus block for arm surgery, and the resident had set things up on the left because the IV tubing came out of the bedclothes on the right. This is why we do our WHO. So we were partway through the injection when this young guy said, "Shouldn't you be doing the other side?" So we ended up with a little bit of block over here and a pretty good block over there. And then there's the mouth going faster than the brain category. There was a man in pre-op who, after a lot of persuasion by his surgeon, had agreed to have his leg amputated because he had gangrene. I knew this had been a very difficult decision for him. So I walked up and I said, "I realize this is a big step for you." He got really angry. I was putting a teenager to sleep for eye muscle surgery. He had a squint. I gave a little defasciculating dose of curare, which might make people weak, and I said, "This medicine might make you cross-eyed." I had a chronic pain patient with pain in his knee that I thought was reflex sympathetic dystrophy, and I'd done a bunch of blocks, finally ending with a neurolytic phenol paravertebral lumbar block, and his pain went away for months. Then his pain came back. So I was talking with him and his wife about treatment possibilities. I said, one possibility is to do the block again on that side. Another possibility is to do the block on the other side, because sometimes sympathetic pain fibers cross. But if we do two sympathetic blocks, bilateral sympathetic blocks, there's the possibility you'll end up with retrograde ejaculation into the bladder. And I said, but look, if that happens, nobody will have to sleep in the wet spot. Okay, I do feel better now. And my deodorant is starting to fail, so let me tell you what Jude and I will do in retirement. First of all, we'll follow the careers of my two sons. Dave Jr. is on the left, he's a general surgeon. Garen is on the right, he's a school teacher and vice principal. We'll follow Kayla's career. Kayla just earned her BFA, and she's bent on Broadway, and she's on her way. We'll watch my grandchildren grow up. You see, Allie, Isabel, Ashley, Rowan, Alec. We'll visit as many national parks as we can, and if we sell the house, we could actually buy this camper. We're going to go fishing. And we have walking paths in the woods behind our house. They need a lot of maintenance, and that's a good thing for a retired gentleman to do. So this next clip we call Life in the Slow Lane. Thank you for coming.